much awaited The Target 2020 series for the month of April 2020 has been uploaded as per the request of viewers. We hope it will be helpful for you in preparing for the UPSC preliminary examination. A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 24th June 2020. These are the list of news articles chosen for today's analysis. It has been provided along with the page numbers of different editions of Hindu newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping for the displayed articles is provided in the description box and also in the comment section. Let's move on to the first article discussion for today. The first discussion for today is based on this news article and this editorial article, which talks about the recent hot topic in the international relations. These news articles are with reference to yesterday's proclamation by the USA's White House. The proclamation is titled as Proclamation Suspending Entry of Aliens Who Present a Risk to the US Labor Market Following the Coronavirus Outbreak. So in this analysis, we will see what this proclamation is about. We'll see about the H-1B visa issue, and we'll also see its implications on India and also on US economy. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. First, let us understand what do we mean by H-1B visa. See, first, a citizen of a foreign country who wishes to enter the United States must obtain a visa. There are two broad types in this visa. One is the non-immigrant visa. This is for temporary stay, like in the category of employment. These visas are for employment that lasts only for a fixed temporary period of time. Then the other is immigrant visa. This immigrant visa is for permanent residence in the USA. Remember that earlier in April 2020, USA suspended issuance of immigrant visa for a period of 60 days. Now this was extended to the end of this year. Now today's discussion is with respect to the non-immigrant visa. See, for different purposes, a foreigner may temporarily go to USA. For example, for tourism and vacation, for education, as exchange visitors in teaching and learning, then as seasonal workers, then for religious work they may go, and for various other reasons, a foreigner may temporarily go to USA. Now, these purposes of travel are related with their corresponding non-immigrant visa categories. And one such non-immigrant visa category is the H-1B visa category. If a person is given H-1B visa, this means that person is going to work in specialty occupations in fields that require highly specialized knowledge. See here, specialty occupation refers to the fact that such occupation requires a higher education degree or its equivalent. Some reports say that such skilled workers are admitted to USA since 1952. And additionally, know that these H-1B visas are also issued for fashion models of distinguished merit and ability. So what is the permitted time period of stay under this H-1B visa? Under this, individuals are admitted for a period of up to 3 years. But this time period may be extended, but generally it cannot go beyond a total of 6 years. But however, some exceptions are even present for this rule of 6 years also under the US legal framework. So is there any limit on such visas in a year? Yes. The H-1B classification has an annual numerical limit or annual cap of 65,000 new visas. In addition to this 65,000, 20,000 persons can be granted this visa, and these are the persons with a master's degree or higher degree from a US institution of higher education. Also know that some of the H-1B visa holders are exempted from this numerical cap. They are the workers who are to be employed at an institution of higher education or its affiliated or related non-profit entities. This also includes workers who are to be employed in a non-profit research organization or a government research organization. This means generally the number of H-1B visas given in the field of research in such institutions is not included in the annual limit. So what is the recent executive order made by the US president? The US president has suspended the new issuance of 4 non-immigrant visas or temporary visas from June 24th till the 31st December of 2020. One of the suspended visas is the H-1B visa. Others are H-2B visa, then J category visa, and then L category visa. In this, just know that H-2B refers to the visa issued to temporary non-agricultural workers. Then L category visa is for the intra-company transferees. This simply means now a company cannot transfer a foreigner to its branch in USA or to its parent company in USA. Then J category visa is issued to those who are to participate in the exchange visitor programs in the United States. And this includes teachers, students, interns, trainees, etc. So this is the background about the H-1B visa and the recent US presidential order. So what does this suspension of visa mean for India? See, according to news articles and reports, in July 2019, the Indian External Affairs Minister informed that in the last 5 years, around 67% to 72% of the total H-1B visas were issued to Indians. This means under H-1B visa, many skilled Indians are getting job opportunities at the USA. In other words, H-1B visa has played an important role in facilitating the movement of talented Indian professionals to USA. Now, for USA, this visa opportunity gave a platform to attract highly skilled laborers at low cost from various countries. That is, it facilitated American companies to recruit critically required workers from overseas for the jobs that the Americans are not willing to do, or we can even say which the Americans are not capable to perform. For these companies, talent and skill is of the utmost importance. And it is also said that these H-1B visa employees are also net job creators in such companies. Now, in this scenario, the recent announcement is seen as a blow to their business operations. Therefore, the editorial article mentions that in the presidential campaign of Mr. Trump for the November elections, he may face opposition from these affected companies. Now, the next implication is that under this visa program, Indian IT companies send low-cost Indian laborers to their client sites in the United States. By this, they avoided high business costs associated with recruiting US citizens for temporary purposes at the client sites. But now, this will not be the case. And also, in this context, Indian IT companies will require this program so as to send Indian workers to their client sites for business operations. But this is affected by the recent decision of the US president. And even USA has not even given a buffer period to stop issuing such visas as well. Then apart from this, the Indian students and teachers might have been planning to carry out exchange student and faculty programs for various reasons despite the pandemic. Now, they might have postponed this visit to be carried out by October of this year or even before the end of this year. Now, they will not be issued the visa to participate in exchange programs. So these are some of the implications on India. Now, apart from this, these two articles note how the move is harmful to the US economy also. See, from the implications which we discussed, it is clear that the US president's executive order will impact the IT firms like TCS, Cognizant, and Infosys. It will also impact big technology companies like Google, Apple, Amazon, and Facebook. It is because they use the H-1B program for their staffing needs. So this decision of US president has been criticized by both the tech leaders in USA and also in India, where they have expressed their concern regarding their staffing needs. Even the Google CEO, Mr. Sundar Pichai, who immigrated to US from India, has underscored the importance of immigration in Google's journey. He noted that immigration has contributed immensely to America's economic success, and that is what in turn made America as a global leader in technology. And additionally, those who criticize the move note that the H-1B program in particular plays a crucial role in addressing the shortage of healthcare professionals in America. So in short, the critics note that every segment of American economy, including manufacturing and medicine, employs skilled workers from other countries for innovation and productivity. But now this will be affected. Now this move is further being criticized because of the pandemic. Because due to the COVID-19 pandemic, the companies in many countries, including the US companies, are trying to recover from the economic fallout. Now, they fear that this new move of US president will make it more difficult for US companies to recover, and thus it will harm the US economy. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the H-1B visa issue. We saw its implications on India, and we also saw how it affects the US economy. And we'll discuss more in the coming days when related news articles appear in the newspaper. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The split practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on this news article. It talks about the few new requirements which has to be adhered by sellers at the government e-marketplace. So in this context, let us see in brief about the government e-marketplace and what are the changes to be adhered by sellers, which are the efforts of the government to promote the Make in India. See, Government e-Marketplace, or in short GEM, is nothing but an online procurement platform for government ministries and departments. This platform is reported as the most widely used channel for public procurement in India. Here, public procurement refers to the process by which governments and state-owned enterprises purchase goods and services from the private sector. Now, in this platform, MSMEs, recognized startups, and other private companies can register as sellers, and they can sell their products and services directly to the government entities. Now, government entities here refers to the ministries and departments of the central governments, then government PSUs, then departments of state governments, also the autonomous bodies of the government, etc. Now, this portal was launched in 2016, and it provides for a completely paperless, cashless, and system-driven e-marketplace. Now, this platform is a special purpose vehicle under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. And the procurement under this GEM portal has been authorized by the General Finance Rules issued by the Ministry of Finance in this regard. See, the launch of the platform is an important reform in the public procurement. It is because now there is openness, transparency, and efficiency in public procurement. Since public procurement utilizes a substantial portion of taxpayers' money, the governments are expected to follow strict procedures to ensure that the procurement process is fair, it is efficient, transparent, and it minimizes wastage of the public resources. For example, if a government department requires 2 laptops, it will post a bid on the GEM website. Then the winner of the bid will get to sell the products to the government department. Now, various advantages offered by this GEM to the sellers and buyers is given here for your reference. So, what is the news today? See, the news is about the steps taken to promote Make in India and Atmanirbhar. First, 2 things are mandated to the sellers in the platform. One, they have to mandatorily mark the country of origin of all the products associated with GEM. Now, next, they have to indicate the percentage of local content in the products. Now, to facilitate the buyers, a Make in India filter is also enabled. Now, the next step is with respect to the local suppliers. See, there are 2 main classes of local suppliers. They are Class 1 and Class 2. Class 1 local suppliers are those whose goods and services and works have more than 50% or equal to 50% of the local content. And the Class 2 local suppliers will have local content of more than 20% and less than 50% in their products and services. Now, the government has informed that the buyers can now reserve any bid for Class 1 local suppliers. This means for such reserved bids, the government will purchase only from the Class 1 local suppliers. Additionally, for bids below 200 crore rupees, only Class 1 and Class 2 local suppliers are eligible to bid. And here the preference will be given to Class 1 suppliers. So these are some of the steps taken recently by Government of India to promote Make in India and to make India a self-reliant economy, or the Atmanirbhar India. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The discrete practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion, which is based on this article about Andhra Pradesh releasing Krishna River water to Chennai. According to the article, Andhra Pradesh has assured to provide Krishna water from Kandaleru Reservoir to meet the drinking water requirements of Chennai. In this context, let us discuss in brief about the Krishna River. See, Krishna River is an interstate river in southern India. It is the second largest river in peninsular India. The largest river in peninsular India is Godavari. I know that Krishna River rises in the Western Ghats at an altitude of 1,337 meters. It rises near the Mahabaleshwar in Maharashtra state. Then it flows across the whole width of the peninsula from west to east, as you can see in this map, for a length of about 1,400 kilometers. Here the blue line represents the river. Now, this river forms a fertile delta in the Andhra Pradesh before draining into the Bay of Bengal. And know that the Krishna Basin extends over Maharashtra, Karnataka, Telangana, and Andhra Pradesh. And it has total catchment area of more than 2.58 lakh square kilometers, which is 8% of the total geographical area of our country. And from examination perspective, we have to know about the important tributaries and important dams on this Krishna River. Now, the principal right bank tributaries of Krishna are Ghataprabha, Malaprabha, and Tungabhadra. Then its important left bank tributaries are Bhima, Musi, and Munnero. Also know that the Koyna River, in which the Koyna Dam is located, is also a tributary of the Krishna River in Maharashtra. Now, this Koyna Dam is known for the 1967 dam-induced earthquake, which killed hundreds of people. Now, apart from this, Panch Ganga, Dud Ganga are also its tributaries. Now, let us see the important dams on Krishna River. The most important one is the Nagarjuna Sagar Dam. It's the world's largest masonry dam located in Andhra Pradesh-Telangana border. Then other important dams are the Almati Dam in Karnataka, then the Sri Sailam Dam in Andhra Pradesh, and then the Tungabhadra Dam in Karnataka. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about the Krishna River, then about its basin details, then also about its important tributaries and dams constructed on this river. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. The display practice question will be discussed in the last session. The next discussion is based on this op-ed article. It is an informative article written by a retired Air Vice Marshal from the Indian Air Force. In this article, author analyzes the efficiency and competitive advantage of Indian Air Force over the People's Liberation Army Air Force, that is the Air Force of China. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. In the introduction, author mentions about how India suffered the defeat in 1962 war when the political leadership, Indian Army as well as Indian Air Force shied away or held back from using the Indian Air Force's offensive element against China. Then author mentions about one more incident wherein India had a chance to strike China offensively as well as defensively in the period 1986 to 87. At that time, the Indian Air Force generals developed a strategy near Tawang in Arunachal Pradesh, and this strategy could have frightened Chinese with numbers, firepower and aggression without confrontation. An important element of this strategy was the use of helicopters and transport aircraft to facilitate and sustain the deployment. And remember, this was at the same place, that is Tawang, where Indian Air Forces suffered defeat in the 1962 war. So as part of this, Indian Air Force even developed an offensive strategy to take the battle to the forwardmost People Liberation Army's base in that sector. But according to the author, this strategy was never put in use. So in this context, author notes that IAF has competitive advantage over China's PLAAF. And this is even reiterated by the Harvard Kennedy School through its recent operational assessments. The Harvard Kennedy School has noted that Indian Air Force currently enjoys both a qualitative advantage and also a quantitative advantage over the Air Force of China across the line of actual control. So, in this article, author lists out how India is in advantageous position as compared with China along the LAC. First, author notes that India's fighter fleet of fourth generation aircraft, which comprises of Su-30 MKIs, then MiG-29s, these are superior in almost every respect to the China's Air Force fighter fleet. Secondly, Indian Air Force has more operational bases than the China's Air Force close to the line of actual control. Then the other area of significant advantage which is enjoyed by Indian Air Force is in the aerial mobility department, where the Indian Air Force transport fleet are proficient in diverse roles similar to the best air forces in the world. And this IAF transport fleet consists of C-17s, C-130s, etc. And even recently, you'd have seen in news about the Chinook and Apache helicopters, which were inducted into Indian Air Force. And in this, the Chinook further enhanced the aerial mobility of Indian Air Force, which is also same with Apache helicopters, which are very lethal in operations. But apart from these advantages, there are also few areas of concern for Indian Air Force, according to the author. And the first concern is that China has a strong ground-based air defense network in Tibet, and it comprises of S-300, S-400, etc. See, even though India has signed the S-400 deal with Russia, it has not yet been delivered to India. Then the second concern is the advantage which China has in the long-range air-delivered cruise missiles. And these air-delivered cruise missiles are with a range between 500 to 3,000 kilometers. But compared to this, the Indian Air Force's Su-30 MKI has just been cleared to carry the BrahMos land attack cruise missile, which has a range of 300 km. So here you can note that China is relatively better with respect to air-delivered cruise missiles as compared to India's Air Force. Then finally, even in the area of surveillance, China possesses a large series of low Earth orbit surveillance satellites. So this would help China to always have an eye on India's movements. So because of this, author notes that to counter China's surveillance advantage, India must leverage its existing space-based surveillance assets and airborne surveillance platforms to keep an eye on China. And thus, as a conclusion, author notes that unless India accepts the importance of Air Force across line of actual control, there is a clear and present danger for India's interests in the LAC. It is because China has invested heavily in modernization of its air fleet. And due to this, Indian Air Force may lose its competitive advantage with China's Air Force within a decade, according to the author. And additionally, if we consider the budgetary allocations to Indian Air Force, there are deep budgetary cuts to Indian Air Force. But if you see, since independence, the Indian Army has enjoyed the lion's share or the largest portion in military's budget. And it is also dominant in decision making. Because of this, we have one of the best land-based militaries in the world. So such kind of importance and budgetary allocation should also be given to Indian Air Force so as to remain at the advantageous position with respect to China. So these are the informative points noted by the author. By analyzing the efficiency and competitive advantages of Indian Air Force over China's Air Force. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. This next discussion is based on this snippet article, which mentions that the central government has planned to levy or impose a basic customs duty of about 20% on the import of solar energy equipment, especially on the equipment's import from China. So in this context, let us discuss in detail about the customs duty. What do we mean by basic customs duty and how it differs from countervailing duty? The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. So first, know that the customs duty is a type of indirect tax which is levied on goods imported into India as well as which is imposed on the goods exported from India. Here, India includes the territorial waters of India, which extend up to the 12 nautical miles into the sea to the coast of India. Now, the primary motive for imposing such customs duty is revenue generation. There are also other motives such as protection of domestic industries from the entry of foreign goods, then for reducing imports, then for protecting forex reserves in times of crisis, and then also for reducing the deficits. And with respect to India, know that the basic law for the imposition and collection of customs duty is the Customs Act of 1962. And from exam purpose, remember the 7th schedule of Indian Constitution provides the Union Government the right to legislate and collect duties on imports and exports. Additionally, know that the Central Board of Indirect Taxes, which is a part of the Department of Revenue under Ministry of Finance, is the apex body for customs matters. Now remember, this Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs was previously known as the Central Board of Excise and Customs. So this CBIC, that is Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, deals with the formulation of policy concerning the imposition of custom duties and collection of custom duties. It formulates policy for prevention of smuggling and evasion of duties also. Then it also formulates policies for all administrative matters relating to customs formations. So why customs duty on exports is imposed? It is imposed to mop up or eliminate the excess profitability in international prices of goods. This happens when domestic price of a good may be low at the given time when we compare that particular good's international price. Now coming to the import customs duty, know that there are several types of import customs duty. They are basic customs duty, additional duty or countervailing duty, then anti-dumping duty or safeguard duty, etc. And our today's focus is with respect to basic customs duty, or in short, BCD. See, it is a standard rate of tax or a preferential rate of tax. This is the tax that is calculated on the assessment value of the goods that have landed at the customs border of India. It can vary between 0% to 100%. And this BCD depends upon the HSN code of the product and the country of import. Here, know that HSN stands for Harmonized System of Nomenclature. Our Indian tariff system is based on this HSN of the Customs Cooperation Council. Also remember, there are some mechanisms which help to reduce this BCD rates, such as the most favored nation arrangements or the arrangements under the free trade agreement or preferential trade agreement can help to reduce the basic customs duty rate. So today's news is that the central government has planned to impose a basic customs duty of about 20% on the import of solar energy equipment, especially from China. This move is expected to give an edge to the domestic manufacturers and also to discourage imports also. See, when an existing BCD is increased or when newly BCD is imposed, it is done with an aim to curb the imports of specified imported items. With the increase in duty, what will happen? The prices of these imported goods will increase. So this will decrease their demand. Then this in turn will reduce the import, and then it indirectly assists the domestic manufacturers because the same product which is domestically manufactured will be lesser in price as compared to that imported item. But here, do not confuse the basic customs duty with countervailing duty, or in short CVD, because CVD is the duty imposed when India finds that a government of the exporting country provides subsidies or assistance to its local industry. And such assistance or subsidies include subsidized loans, tax exemptions, indirect payments, etc. To understand this, let us take one example. Assume that we import finished electronic items from China, and the Chinese government is providing tax exemptions to its manufacturers and businesses. So when there is tax exemption given by the Chinese government to the manufacturers, that means they can manufacture the product at a lesser price. This means they can export and sell electronic items for a price less than what the Indian electronic companies can reasonably manufacture and sell in India. So when Indian domestic industries could not sell a product below a certain reasonable price and an imported item could be sold lesser than that price, that means that product is injuring the domestic product. So when such injury happens, then the government imposes the countervailing duty. Or in other words, we can say that to neutralize the adverse effects of subsidies or assistance of the exporting country, which is given to its manufacturers or businesses, the government of India imposes CVD. And similarly, any country can impose CVD on any of the countries from which it imports, if it feels that that particular country is affected by the actions of the exporting country. And with respect to India, as per Section 9 of the Customs Tariff Act of 1975, which provides for imposing of CVD, the central government may impose a countervailing duty not exceeding the amount of subsidy given by the exporting country. So that is all about this discussion. In this discussion, we saw about customs duty. Then we saw about two types of import customs duty, which is basic customs duty and then countervailing duty. With this, we come to the end of this discussion. Now, we have come to the last session for today, which is the practice questions discussion session. Now, this question is a prelims question on Krishna River. The first statement mentions its drainage basin extends over Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, and Andhra Pradesh. Now, this statement is incorrect because during discussion, we saw that the drainage basin of Krishna River extends over Maharashtra, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Tamil Nadu should not be present in this statement. So, first statement is incorrect. Now, the second statement mentions Tungabhadra, Malaprabha and Bhima are its important tributaries. Now, this statement is correct. Here, Tungabhadra and Malaprabha are important right bank tributaries of Krishna River and Bhima is an important left bank tributary of Krishna River. Now, before marking the answer, be careful because the question asks for the incorrect statements. And here, statement 1 is incorrect. So, the correct answer is option A, 1 only. Now, this next question asks, customs duty is an indirect tax levied on goods imported into India as well as exported from India. Which of the following is or are not an import customs duty? First one is countervailing duty, second one is basic customs duty, third one is anti-dumping duty. So remember, all these three are import customs duties only. And in today's discussion, we saw about two of them. One is countervailing duty and the other one is basic customs duty. And here the question asks, which among them is not an import customs duty? Now, since all of them are import customs duty, the correct answer is option D, none of the above. Now, this next question is based on government e-marketplace. Three statements are given. The first statement is, it is a special purpose vehicle under Ministry of Consumer Affairs, Food and Public Administration. Now, this statement is incorrect because Government e-Marketplace is a special purpose vehicle or SPV under the Ministry of Commerce and Industry, not under Consumer Affairs Ministry. Now, the second statement is, in the platform, the main seller is the government and its agencies, whereas the main procurers are private players. Now, this statement is incorrect because it is a platform for public procurement, which means the process by which governments and state-owned enterprises purchase goods and services from the private player. So here in the statement, it is oppositely mentioned. It is the government which procures from the private players. So the statement is incorrect. And here the question asks for the correct statements. So that means if you eliminate two in the given options, that is if you eliminate option A, B and D, you will arrive at the correct answer, which is option C, 3 only. The third statement mentions GEM Startup Runway allows startups to reach out to the universe of government buyers by offering innovative products unique in design, process and functionality. See, this statement is correct because the GEM Startup Runway was launched in 2019 in association with the Startup India Mission. In this runway, startups can spread awareness about their products by completing a form that describes their product and their intended buyers and users. The benefits for startups in GEM has been given here for your reference. So third statement is correct and the correct answer is option C, 3 only. Now let us take one mains question based on GS paper 2. The recent announcement made by USA to suspend some of the non-immigrant visas affect both Indian and US economies. Justify. First, this is a justify question. So you have to first mention about the recent announcement about suspending the non-immigrant visas, which is the H-1B visas. Then you can, its implications on Indian economy and US economies. Like for Indian economy, you can mention that Indian companies will not be able to send their staff to the client companies. Then you can mention that many skilled Indians who were getting job opportunities at USA will be losing those job opportunities. Then you can mention that the already planned student exchange and faculty programs could not be carried out because of this announcement. Then for US economy, you can mention that many IT firms and tech giants use the H-1B program for their staffing needs. Then you can mention that the immigration has contributed immensely to America's economic success, which in turn made America a global leader in technology. Then you can say that before this, the shortage of healthcare professionals in America was fulfilled by this H-1B program. Now this will not be done. So like this, you can mention many other viewpoints and write the answers in 150 words and post it in the comment section. We'll review it and appropriate suggestion will be provided in a reasonable time frame. With this, we have come to the end of today's Hindi news analysis. And if you like today's analysis, don't forget to like, comment and share among your friends. And for more videos related to UPSC Civil Service Examination, you can visit our Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel.